Hello everybody! We finally managed to reach our final fourth lecture of the seventh module of Compass Project Business Development and Fundraising. Today, for our last time, I have chosen to speak about financial institutions and organizations. As I would like to remind you, my name is Lubomira Dimitrova and I'm here presented by Bulgaria Development Agency. I wish that all the previous lectures were useful for you and you will find inspiration and tips for forming your own company. The first financial institution which we are going to speak about are banks. It can be quite difficult to understand banking since banks are very different from most other businesses. For one thing, they are highly leveraged with more than 20 euros in debt for every 1 euro of equity. Also, it can be hard to understand what banks actually do, since they don't make any real products. And a lot of people seem to think that banking is free, probably because banks keep advertising free checking accounts, free direct deposits, free bill payments, and so on. Before we go further, we have to make clear what is the 363 rule. To fully understand how banks make money, you need to understand a little about the history of banking. Traditionally, banks make money from borrowing from depositors at low interest rates, lending that money at higher interest rates to borrowers, and pocketing the difference. Banking used to be heavily regulated following the 363 business rule: borrow money at 3%, lend it at 6%, and be at the golf course by 3 p.m. Most banks also charged a monthly fee to customers for maintaining a basic account, but most daily transactions were free. But overall, fees were low, constituting only 30% of the total revenues. In order to make clear how the bank makes money, there are three main sources of revenue in retail banking today. Net interest margin. This is the difference or a net between the interest paid to depositors and the interest received from the borrowers. Many large banks are making margins of 4% at the moment, which are even higher than the 3% from the good old days of the 363 rule. There is also an inter-exchange method. Every time you swipe a card at a store, the merchant pays the small percentage of the money to the bank that used the card, called an interchange fee. For credit cards, this is around 1.7%, while for debit cards, it's nearer to 1.1%. There are also fees. These are the fees that your bank charges you, including the ATM fee, overdraft fees, late payment fees, penalty fees, and so on. Along with the interexchange, these fees add up to more than 50% of revenue for large banks. So with the most recent banking crisis, a handful of banks now dominate the market. At this scale, basic retail banking is immediately profitable. Unfortunately for consumers, they don't really have a choice. Yes, customers can move their money to smaller banks, but small banks were also hit by the crisis and typically not all interest in customer service beyond the branch. So, while you may be able to find a small local bank to serve you, the cost of banking and experience may not be as convenient as the one of the big banks. The next type of funding organization which we are going to discuss are angel investors. Before going further, you should check up what we have learned last week regarding equity funds. Angel investors may be professionals such as doctors or lawyers, former business associates, or better yet, seasoned entrepreneurs interested in helping out the next generation. What matters is that they're wealthy and willing to invest hundreds and thousands of euros in your business in return for a piece of the action. Angel investments simply give you money. You sell them equity in the company, filling the investment raise with the SEC. Most investments round also involve multiple investors thanks to the profilators of angel groups. There are both upsides and downsides of choosing angel investors. From the upside, angel investments can be perfect for businesses that are established enough that they are beyond the startup phase, but still are early enough in the game that they need capital to develop a product or fund a market strategy. Many businesses receiving angel investments already have some revenue, but they need some cash to kick the enterprise to the next level. Not only can an angel investor provide this, but he or she might become an important mentor. Because their money is on the line, they will be highly motivated to see your business succeed. However, from the downside, you could be giving away anywhere from 10 to more than 50% of your business. On the top of that, there is always the risk that your investors will decide that you are the business' greatest obstacle to success and you could get fired from the company you created. Angel investors, like venture capitalists, about which I'm going to speak in a minute, also like to see the end game down the road that will allow them to pocket their winnings, whether it is a public offering or your business getting acquired by another company. You might have to give up running your enterprise before you're done having fun with it. These days though, angel groups are profiling, offering plenty of mentoring and coaching on the top of the money provided. The third type of financial institution which we are going to discuss are the crowdfundings. Crowdfunding is a way to raise money, awareness and support for a project from the people around you. It means a funding that allows individuals to make their ideas a reality with the power of the crowd. Crowdfunding enables people with the great ideas to raise the money they need in return for rewards. The public can back your idea with pledges of money and project owners can thank their backers with rewards that reflect the money contributed. When it comes to the success rates, too many people begin a crowdfunding campaign without proper preparation. Kickstarter reports that more than 200,000 rewards-based projects were started last year, which is evidence of the popularity. However, only 40% of those projects actually received funding, and that's not counting the 20% of the projects submitted to Kickstarter that were rejected, or the thousands of equity-based projects submitted to other crowdfunding websites. Still, from 30 to 40% is a decent number to go by when considering the benefits of crowdfunding campaigns. The statistics more likely indicate that the campaigns are failing because people begin them without the proper knowledge of how to keep them going, rather than indicating that crowdfunding itself does not work. However, there are some successful techniques. All in all, crowdfunding can be successful for those who know the proper approach to take with their campaign. The 30-40% of businesses who have found success adhere to a variety of trackers for crowdfunding success. Though tactics will vary slightly across the board, most will have a few things in common. Here are some of the techniques successful crowdfunders have used in the past. The first advice is to prepare ahead of time. Starting a crowdfunding campaign is not as simple as posting your campaign on a crowdfunding website. It takes an ample preparation. In general, plan to spend 1 to 2 months in preparing for your campaign, in which you hash out every detail you need for success. Secondly, you should get help. Even if this is not your first crowdfunding endeavor, you can always benefit from a boost from professionals, particularly if you are performing an equity-based campaign. Without proper guidance, you may not recognize when investors are taking advantage of you in the amount of equity they request. Look for a website that will do more than simply host your campaign, one that will help you perfect your campaign and guide you as you seek investors, such as the Huffington Post as the crowdfunding platform that is arguably the most successful platform in terms of actual funds raised. You also need to define an audience. Successful crowdfunders know exactly who their audience is and how to market directly to them. Your audience will be comprised of friends and fans of your project, and you can branch out even more backers from there. Without an audience as a startup, success will be a difficult achievement. You should always have a revolutionary idea as well. Investors like to see a new, fresh ideas that either offer groundbreaking technology or considerable advancement of existing technology. Make sure your idea has the potential to be worth millions before you start asking for the funding. You should focus on the market as well. Some campaigns will attract files like honey, but crowdfunding is not one of them. It takes a considerable amount of marketing to reach an audience well enough to gain funding. Successful campaign marketing requires classic marketing techniques, including personal contact, advertising, email marketing, social media promotions, and much more, with constant dialogue to your case. The fourth type of financial institution which we are going to discuss is the venture capitalists. What is the difference between the venture capitalists and the angel investors? We are going to respond to that question in a second. You may have a startup or even a small business that has got off the ground. You might have the skills and the experience, the team and the enthusiasm to take it to the next level. But all that could come to naught if you don't get your financing strategy right. From the first spark of an idea to setting up a business and making it grow, at various points of the journey, an entrepreneur will consider venture capital funding for his startup to thrive, scale, and go farther and faster. But the process can be daunting for a newbie entrepreneur. Whom to take money from? Is the business fundable in the first place? There are many questions to answer, but if you tackle them before going off on a hunt for a venture capital, you will save time and improve your chances. There are thousands of venture capital funds out there now looking for startups in Asia to fund. But most startups won't even get a chance to make a pitch to a sought after investor. Your best bet is to be as well prepared as you can be, and this How to Guide aims to get you started. What is a venture capital funding? Pension funds, insurance companies, and wealthy individuals invest in real estate, stocks, and other assets. They allocate around 10% of their money into riskers investors with higher returns, aka startups. They channel those investments through venture capital funds mostly. They are most often being run by ex-entrepreneurs, financial wizards, and the like set up venture capital funds. These general partners or GPs will decide on the size of the fund whether they want to invest it and come up with the offering memorandum. Based on this, various investors will commit their money to a venture capital fund and become limited partners or LPs in the fund, which is GPs will run. How are the venture capital funds investment made and managed? Once the money is committed from pension funds and other investors, and the fund is closed, the GPs will find investment opportunities, or source deals, as they say. They might look at 50 to 100 opportunities for each one they pick to fund and exchange for equity. GPs will also sit on the boards of directors in these companies to manage the investors. Acquisition of a startup or its IPO, initial public offering, is when the venture capital fund's partners get their returns. A venture capital fund can be considered to be doing well if one-third of its portfolio companies provide the partners with such exit. The usual time frame of the exit is 5 to 7 years, and the life of the fund is 10 years. The GPs take an annual management fee, or 2 to 3% of the capital committed to the fund, for salaries and expenses. They also get 20 to 30% share of the spoils from exits, usually after the LPs have got their capital back. So the reward system is such as the venture capitalists need to find the new big winners and find them quickly. In a business like ours, you starve your losers and give money to your winners. This is not about those 10 failures or 10 moderators out of 18. This business is about those 4 or 5 companies who succeed and the of the moderates. And this explains Prag Do, managing director of Inventus Advisors. What are the progressive stages of venture capital funding? Venture capitalists will typically invest a third of the fund in the first 3 years. Depending on the venture capitalist performance, the money can be invested anywhere from the seed stage to the growth stage. The remaining two-thirds of the funds will go into follow-on late-stage rounds for portfolio companies which gain traction and can be positioned for an acquisition of an IPO. The rest will more or less will be left to their own devices. So a venture capitalist-funded startup basically has a three-year window to get going on a scale-up. The GPs need a few early winners so that they can go back to the LPs and raise second funds midway through the life cycle of the first one. Two funds under management give GPs headroom. Even though this is not a business institution per se, you should consider family and friends as a source for funding as well. Monies, usually in the form of a loan, that a business owner gets from either the family members or friends in order to help finance their startup or growing business. The most common source of debt financing for startups often isn't the commercial lending institutions, but family and friends. It makes sense. People with whom you have close relationship know you are reliable and competent, so there should be no problem in asking for a loan, right? Keep in mind, however, that asking for a financial help isn't the same as borrowing the car. While borrowing money from family and friends may seem as an easy alternative to dealing with bankers, it could actually be a more delicate situation, and it's important to be as disciplined as you would be in dealing with a professional investor. Here are some basic rules. Treat them as they were strangers. Forget for the moment that your investor is a friend or family member. Make it an arm's length transaction and insist on the same sort of legal documentation you would prepare if your investor was a total stranger. Why is the reason for that? Because too many entrepreneurs borrow money from family and friends on an informal basis. The terms of the loan have been verbalized but not written down in the contract. Lending money can be tricky for people who cannot view the transaction at arm's length. If they don't feel you're running your business correctly, they might step in and interfere with your operations. In some cases, you can't prevent this, even with a written contract, because many state laws guarantee voting rights to an individual who has invested money in a business. This can, and it has, created a lot of hard feelings. Make sure to check with your attorney before accepting any loan from a friend or family. So, if it's a loan, have your lawyer prepare your promissory note for the friend or family member and don't offer less than a commercial interest rate. Tie all payments to your cash flow. Try to avoid obligations with fixed repayment schedules. Consider interest cash flow obligations in which your investor will receive percentage of your operating cash flow until they either have been repaid in full with interest or have achieved a specified percentage return to their investment. Consider non-voting stock. If your friend or family member insists on buying stock in your company, try to make it as non-voting stock so they don't have the right to second-guess your every management decision. With that, we will finish our models. Have in mind that this is just a glimpse of the old knowledge you can get from the internet, in libraries, TV, even your friends and relatives who are running a company. The essential thing is to have a clear idea in your mind about your business, and the rest it will occasionally follow. So we finally reached the section in which I'm speaking about the readings for the current lecture. As you can see, this time you have two obligatory and three optional ones. The obligatory ones, to a larger extent, are similar to the information which has already been given, but in any case it will give you a better and a deeper understanding about the things which we are speaking about and may give you different ideas and creativity in order to use the best way and the best institution suitable for you and your future organization. As for the optional readings, I have decided to pick those sites and platforms and articles which may give you ideas for different funding opportunities, as well as sites for crowdfunding and crowdsourcing. I hope that you will find this information useful, and I'll be very glad if you continue searching again to find better opportunities or institutions which will help you to develop your dream idea for a company. Again, for the last time, I'm going to present you the sources for this lecture. Feel free to go through all of them if you find anything interesting or inspirational, and to use it and duplicate it in your future career. So that's it. That is our last slide from our last lecture, and I hope that I was not too boring and you really liked the things which you have read and you found them interesting and useful. Again, I wish you a lot of good luck and success, and I hope that the Compass program will help you to achieve your dreams and to find the best suitable career for your skills and interests. So once again, thank you very much for your attention and patience. I wish you a good day and a lot of success. Thank you very much, and I hope you find this model useful.